Tipperary 1-7, Limerick 1-4.
This is Jimmy Barry Murphy, hurler and footballer. And this is Jimmy Barry Murphy's shot, it's there!
David Fitzgerald, here's the goal shot, sorry for Clare. He scored! They came, they believed, they knew they could conquer, and they've done it!
It's one of the great occasions of the summer. What a day to be a fan of the Daisha.
Yeah, some of the reasons that make the Munster final great. I know every provincial final is special in its own way. We had to pick one, and given that Thurles is the home of the GAA, the spiritual home of hurling, and it's hosting the final next week, we chose the Munster Hurling final for this programme. Now, we have a host of great names to meet during the programme, with a special welcome too for the president of the GAA, who's with us, Christy Cooney. And I know some of you are waiting anxiously for today's action. Don't worry, it's coming up shortly. But first, let's meet three of the many great names associated with Munster Hurling. And with us tonight, we have Babs Keating from Tipperary, Eamon Cregan from Limerick, and Micheál Muirheartaigh, who this year is celebrating the 60th anniversary of his first commentary, which you're looking well in it still, Micheál. You're getting away with it still. What does the Munster Hurling final mean to you?
Well, it's special. And I often try to figure out when it all started. And I think it started in 1926. A provincial final, it was nothing huge up to then, was being played at Cork. A huge crowd turned up, no proper stewarding, it wasn't a fashion at the time, the game was abandoned. It was refixed for Thurles, 1926. Tom Semple was put in charge of stewarding. It worked a wonder. A huge crowd turned up, a magnificent game. It was the first game in Munster to be broadcast. And the second in the world. It ended in a draw, the replay was equally good, and ever since that day, I think Munster Hurling finals are special. They're, I think, the equal of any sporting event anywhere in the world. Atmosphere, great players in action, a good crowd turning up, a fantastic spirit always in the Munster final. It's something different, and I love going to Munster finals. Thank God I have seen many, and I hope to see many more. I sat down there for the past 10 minutes. Kevin Hennessy. Everyone heard of Kevin Hennessy sitting near me, fairly big man. I said, how many Munster finals did you play in? He said, 11. Now, I didn't ask for any more information, but he said, and I won 7 of them, he said. So it's great. They all like to look back, I'd say, on Munster finals, the great deeds that took part in them. I'd like to pick just one. And he was sitting behind me there. The goal that Nicky English kicked in 1987. He kicked it, you know. It ended in a draw again. 1987, the replay was taken to Killarney. They were all fantastic games. Everything was present in that game. And even recently, I learned about that goal, thing I didn't know up to then. I met a man called Joe Hayes, and I mentioned that goal of Nicky's. And Joe said to me, do you know who sent the ball into? I said, no. I sent it in and I imparted the proper spin so that it was right for the kick. Something memorable about every Munster final.
Well, Babs, you were coach of that team. That was when the famine was over for Tip. I mean, did it mean as much to you coaching Tipperary to success as it did playing?
Well, that one did, Des, because we were the first to start a supporters club. And the burden of, you know, collecting money and giving people value for money. And I carried that burden with Donny and Theo. And, like, Tipperary got behind us. And we have to think, like, that 87 we were in a recession as well. And particularly in Tipperary, because Tipperary hosted the All-Ireland of 84. And the county was really drained. No money. Mike Lurie gave me the job and he told me, you have the job now, but you don't have the price of a hurling ball. So the responsibility of, you know, providing getting value success, for money. Yeah. And to be fair, we had a team that did provide value for money, and I was grateful for the goal that Nicky kicked. And I must tell you a story about that, Micheál. I walked off the field with Mickey Sheehy, and it was around the time that Maradona was at his best. And now for Mickey Sheehy to express the view that he did that day, he said, you know, he said, I don't think Maradona would have kicked that goal. And Nicky is here in the audience, but the following week training, I asked Nicky to attempt to kick the goal. I gave him 10 chances, and Ken Hogan saved the 10. Eamon, but to tell you the brilliance of him, when he had to do it, he did it.
Eamon, the 73 Munster final, I presume, stands out for you, does it, on your way to a Limerick
final? It does, because just prior to that, in the 60s, you had the moving statues in Ballinspittle, and we had the moving goalposts in Thurles that day. The right, Len?
This was for the late...
But, yes, this point that Richie scored. But it was... You know, we'd been trying and trying for years. And like, Babs was talking about the recession in 87. I was reared in Limerick City in the 50s, 40s and 50s. And there was a depression then. Yeah. So, you know, we were used to that, and we were used to Tipperary and Cork playing a Munster Championship. Which one?
There's your skinny little Eamon Cregan there getting his goal. And but it was, what age were you when you first saw a Munster final?
I think I was 7. And Tipperary were playing Cork, as per usual, during the 50s. And Seamus Bannon was playing, and I remember he running the length of the field and scoring a goal. And I also remember Richie and I were talking about this, the Munster final in 61 with Cork and Tipperary, and this famous John Dyle incident where there were 61,000 officially. Munster Council generally say give you an official figure, but the unofficial figure we think was about 70,000. And that it was packed. And Tony Redden was playing, and I always remember him coming out and he blocking the ball. In the 50s, Tony came out, and I saw, going back to the 50s, I saw a Munster Championship match between Tip and Cork at the same time. And hurleys were flying now, you know, the dust around the square. And Tony Redden was above there in the audience, came out, caught the ball in amongst, I think, 7 or 8 hurleys, took a step to the right and drove it down the field. And I was behind the goals watching it, and I thought it was a magnificent save.
What was your first one, Babs?
52. Huge disappointment because, you know, Tipperary were after winning 3 in a row. It was Tony Redden at his best. And now I was in the years that I wanted Tip to win. And I'm glad Tony is here in the audience tonight, because I would say that Tip team of 49, 50 and 51 were the team that sowed the seeds for the success that Tipperary had all through the 60s. We were at the age where there was no soccer, no rugby, no other sport on television. Yeah. And that Tipperary team, they were household names. And to me, we all looked up to the Kennys and Stakedom and Shanahan and all that team. Sure. So, it's great to see Redden here tonight and his wife, Maura. So.
Okay, Micheál, who is your favourite hurler down through the years in Munster?
There'd be so many of them.
I'd have to
mention John Fenton. He captained a team to win the All-Ireland in centenary year. And then that goal he scored in the semi-final against Limerick in 1987 in Thurles. I doubt if Maradona and all the best in the world put together could have scored that. From so far out, the trajectory, the speed, the perfection, the swing and everything. He was a stylish hurler. There are others, you know, great hurlers. If I'm forced to pick one, I'd say just John Fenton.
And we'll have him try it 10 times out in the garden when we're finished later on and see how he gets on with repeating that goal. Now, over the last couple of weeks, we've been running a competition asking you to vote for your top hurler in Munster over the past 25 years, since centenary year. We've had a massive response to the competition, and later in the programme, we'll be finding out just who you voted as the best Munster hurler since centenary year. Yeah, they're just some of the great contenders for the title who may rank alongside some of the great names of the previous 100 years. Names like Christy Ring and Mick Mackey.
When he was going out to the field, he held the hurley up in the hand. Always had the hurley up in the hand when he was going out onto the pitch. And the minute he hit the pitch, the daisies, as I said, got a sudden death. He played like a dancer. He was like a dancer.
He won every 50-50 ball, mainly through his strength and his desire to get a ball, you know. He said, if the ball is in the referee's pocket, you have to see it in there. He was perfection itself.
The contest was the most important thing for me. I mean, playing the game was the most important thing, as far as I was concerned. It wasn't what I got from it or what was at the end, but to play hurling for Cork, and that was the most important thing.
He was amazing. He was everything you'd look up to in life. He was a man with his own mind. He didn't care about anybody, you know, even though he was very respectful. I've never heard him say a bad word in his life. He would be the GAA's Shakespeare. He was not alone a Corkman. You could never confine Ruin to a county. Ruin was Ireland. No, hurling is Ireland. Ruin was hurling, Ruin is Ireland. That's what I think.
I just didn't play anymore when the time came. Not that I didn't feel I couldn't play, but I felt I'd done enough, and I'm sure I have, really, from the point of view that you should have somebody else here today instead of me. It's about time they stopped talking about me.
Two different styles, two different players. The Ruin depended on his artistry, left and right, and Gustav Burton, Fred and Atten. But Mackie depended on his solo runs with the hurley, with the ball and the hurley, and going through fellas, going through the backs. That was his style.
Well, I was always strong, and I know I was strong, really, from hitting against fellas like older fellas and all that. You felt this, I mean, I can take that fella type of thing. Just as the years went on, you said to yourself, I'm sorry that I didn't do this or do that, you know. If you were to go back a second time, you'd play different, really. And you'd do different things, but you won't ever get a second chance.
Well, I meant everything to Limerick, because they looked up to him. They looked upon him as a real captain, as a man that could bring him to a Munster final, to an Ireland.
I think the greatest thrill I got, really, was beating Dublin in a replay in 1934. That I collected an All-Ireland medal, because we'd have been beaten in 33, went up for the All-Ireland, and we looked a certainty. And I think that was my greatest thrill. When the whistle blew anyhow, well, I said I got an All-Ireland medal anyhow.
You were to get two more afterwards, of course.
I got two more after, really, and was beaten a point by one. Of course, they always say that I lost the 35-1 by missing a free, but that never worried me, really.
Yeah, I went to Tullis to see Mackie given an exhibition. Carried the whole Limerick support on his shoulders. He was an outstanding man.
Yeah. Some great archive there, isn't there? Well, with me now is Jimmy Brown from the Black Rock Club in Cork, and from Patrick's Well in Limerick is Richie Bennis. You actually played with Christy, Jim.
I did, Des. I was quite young at the time. I came on the scene with the Cork team in 1953, and Ruin was well established at that period, and it was a great experience for me to be on the same team as with him.
He came across there as a shy, kind of retiring man.
Well, I always said that about him, that basically he was very shy, and he never imposed himself on anybody, never spoke about his greatness on the field of play, but was always encouraging people to be better than what they should be.
Yeah. And was it his longevity that he played for so long, or was it all his titles, or was it what he did that made him so special?
Well, I was amazed. I was looking up some books during the week there, and Ruin played minor All-Ireland final in 1938, which Cork won, and then he carried on, played all through the 40s, the 50s, and into the early 60s. Yeah. So that was a huge span of time for any one player. Absolutely. To be playing.
At the top level.
Yeah, at the top level, and a tough level.
Yeah. Was he a tough man as well?
Oh, he was well able to look after himself, let me put it down.
Coming from a Black Rock man, that's something. Richie, you didn't see Mick Mackey play, obviously, but he has this legendary status in Limerick. He means a lot to Limerick hurlers.
Yeah, he meant everything to Limerick hurling, because prior to me coming on the scene in 43 and 73, it was all about Mick Mackey and the team in the 40s and the 30s. Yeah. So I saw a ring player, right? And I went down to a lot of county finals in Cork, where there'd be in the early 60s when there'd be 30,000 people at a county final. And I saw it in 61, the money Eamon Cregan was talking about there, when actually there was, I suppose, the 80,000 people at it. And there was bottles of water sold for a shilling that day. And two people actually died at the match that day. The crowd was so intense.
Wow. And what about 73? You came along then and you're now carrying that mantle, isn't it? Isn't the time it was passed on to the younger lads in Limerick?
Very much so. We're there to remember for all the wrong reasons. It's an awful pity we didn't win one in between. Mm-hmm. We left a few behind us, I think, especially in 94 and 96. Because the team in those 2 years were plenty good enough to win the All-Ireland. But these things happened, and of course we left the one behind us in 2007 that I was involved in. And
are you getting closer?
To what side? I have my doubts. It doesn't, but still you never know.
You never know. Well, I hope it does. Everyone would love to see. Yeah. Limerick do well. Well, tonight's programme, of course, is unique with a live studio audience on the Sunday game for the very first time. And amongst them, a man who, in my view, is a true legend in the broader sense.
Again, it's John Fitzgibbon raiding. Sullivan moving inside, perhaps to take a pass, but Fitzgibbon going it alone. Tremendous run into Kevin Hennessy. Space at a premium, looking for some through the target. He's got a goal!
Yeah, Kevin Hennessy has been spoken about already, as he tends to be. Kevin, it's great to have you here, just looking at the goal there. But I think, apart from the battles you had with the Tipperaries and everyone else, you had your own personal battle in recent years. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I had, like a lot of people like me, I got sick and I went up to the hospital and I was expecting to be home shortly. I had a few headaches and they told me that I had 5 brain tumours. And we discovered afterwards they were inoperable, so I went through the treatments. Radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and I'm finished with that now. That was 3 years ago now, this month, I'd say. And to tell you now about fellas playing against you, and you'd kill him if you got a chance in the field, but I had fierce support from the likes of Tomás Moyle, John Fenton, Geoff Fitz, Nick English was great when I was in the hospital, you know. Things like that, and he sent me up a card signed by all the Tipperary fellas that I played against. They're the camaraderie you meet off the field. And the field was a bit different, this. Yeah.
Who was the toughest fella on the field?
Well, I found them all tough, this. Yeah. Like, myself and Ring, Chris Tearing, the Greg Ring, had one thing in common. I wasn't as good as him, but I was very shy like him.
That goal, that was the only goal we could find in the archives. Did you get any other
goals?
You
didn't look too fair enough. we see what Munster Hurling was sticking with now, right?
Yeah.
John Fenton, that day he got the goal, I was nearest man to it, past Tommy Quaid, not messing him. But I got one after, I kicked for 2 yards, like, but just still scored the same, you know? And I mean, these things, we witnessed great moments. They're not about Munster Hurling. For me personally, Cork and Tip and Tullis. No matter where else, we played Tip one time, Babs, and was 87 there. I happened to be captain that year, Babs, believe it or not. And Stakelam was another 8-8, he was captain for Tip. But it was down in Killarney, the replay. And I remember the draw match in Tip, and the players came to me to say, go to the county board there before they went to the meeting. Tell them, look, if they won't come to Cork, we'll come back here. Cork love going to Tullis. Yeah. And, you know, it's the same thing. I'll be honest with you, I'll respect to the other counties. Cork and Tip for me in Tullis is the real Munster final. Right? Right.
Who'll win the All-Ireland this year, Kevin?
Oh, the Dublinites, they're Hattings. So they always think they're going to win every day anyway.
Coming from a Cork man, that's a bit rich, I have to say. Now, I struggle with that one, Kevin. Anyway, it's great to have you here. Thanks for being here. Now, we have a special competition on tonight's programme with the winner receiving 2 VIP tickets to next Sunday's Munster Hurling final between Waterford and Tipperary, with 2 nights accommodation and dinner in the Anner Hotel in Thurles, plus €1,000 in spending money. To enter, all you have to do is correctly answer the following question. Who are the defending Munster Senior Hurling champions? Waterford, Tipperary or Cork? To enter, call 1515 71 71 84 with your selection or text hurling followed by your answer and contact details to 57111. The number to call from Northern Ireland is 0901 293 0231. Terms and conditions are on Airtel page 193. Lines remain open until 11 p.m. tonight. You must be over 18 years of age to enter. The winning entry will be announced at the end of this programme. All right, good luck with that. It's a great prize. Now, in recent decades, we've witnessed some amazing moments in the Munster Hurling Championship, from the intense rivalry of Cork and Tip in the 80s that we heard about, to the emergence of Clare in the 90s, to Waterford's amazing battle with Cork in 2004.
Shanahan's the one inside. He has it! He scores! This to send to the Munster final. With the boot to Malini, he scores!
Great stuff. You know, Babs just told me there, Aidan Ryan's goal, when he scored that goal for Tip and the crowd ran onto the pitch. One fella in a wheelchair came onto the pitch as well during the game when he got the goal. Well, time now to pay a visit to the home of hurling, the home of the GAA indeed, Hayes' Hotel in Thurles, where the GAA was formed 125 years ago this year. We've got some great names down there, and amongst them is Marty Morrissey. Let's go down and see how they're looking after Marty. How are you, Marty?
Hello, Des, and indeed a very warm welcome here to where it all began. 125 years ago, Hayes' Hotel in the centre of Thurles. Well, as you mentioned in your introduction there, Des, lots of big names that we have for you here tonight. And we start with two legends of Munster hurling. Beside me here is Mick Roach, who won five Munster championships and three All-Irelands, and on the very first All-Star team back in 1971. And beside him is the dashing Pat Hartigan, who of course won five All-Stars by the age of 24, and of course two Munsters and an All-Ireland in 73. Let me begin with you, Pat. Growing up in South Liberties, what was it about the Munster Championship? Why was it so special, and that you in particular wanted to participate in it?
Well, Marty, we were very fortunate throughout the 60s that most of the Munster Championship finals were contested at the Gaelic Grounds in Limerick. And growing up in 61 as an 11-year-old at that time, it was the highlight of your summer holidays to go to the Munster final. And, you know, we rarely got to the All-Ireland final because, or got to see the All-Ireland final because school was starting the next day, so we had to make the best of the Munster Championship. But from my point of view, the 1961 Munster final was the first Munster Championship match that I actually saw, and it had a lot of uniqueness about it. It had, of course, we mentioned it was spoken about earlier on, but Christy Ring and John Doyle, between them they had 12 All-Ireland medals. They were marking each other in the final, and it was that particular day that Christy Ring coined the phrase, where a small bandage, a small cut deserved a big bandage and a big cut deserved no bandage. So I think that Christy Ring took that through, and I remember subsequently asking him about that, and he said it was always important that when you got an injury like that, that it was seen as partly an accident, because when you went back in to meet your corner back, he was always wondering how long he'd have to wait before he'd get the same from you. So that kept him busy during the course of the game.
And Pat, just about 1973, because it was 18 years, I think, since you won the Munster Championship, and the All-Ireland was a huge success, obviously, for you.
Limerick played in the 1955 Munster Final, and we beat Clare on that occasion. 71, we suffered a defeat to Tipperary in the Munster Final in Killarney. And in 1973, as you rightly said, Marty, 18 years afterwards, we had a chance for what we would regard as the real Munster Final. Because the day you travel to Thurles, you're going through towns like Newport, Upper Church, Rare Cross, Killiscully, and it's just Tipperary heartland. And to go into Tipperary and to take on the Kings of Hurling at that time, beat it by a point in the Munster Final.
Great win.
Outstanding.
Mick Roach, if I can bring you into this conversation, because the Munster Championship is very important to you. Your outstanding memory.
Well, there are many memories, of course, but the most important one, all Munster Finals are important, of course, but I think the one in 87 was very important. We had been 15 or 16 years in the doldrums, you would say, and it was a draw the first day, and it went to extra time the second day in Killarney. I'll always remember for Richard Stakelam's famous, in his speech, he was talking about Messiahs and the famine was over and all of that. No, they didn't go on to finish the job that year, but that was a real turning point, there's no doubt.
And Mick, why is Simple Stadium so important? Why is it so precious to the Munster Championship?
Well, I think people, first of all, there's a lot of things to be said about it, but I think people love coming to Thurles. Players love to play there, supporters love to come here. I've never yet met a player from any county who didn't tell me he loved to play in Thurles. And from a supporter's point of view, when you walk from the train station, you practically can see Semple Stadium, and you're only 5 or 6 minutes stroll to the square, which is the attraction, which is the mecca, where you have people on Munster Final Day wear their county colours with pride.
Absolutely.
They mightn't wear them other days. And there's a great atmosphere created in the square where people have a beer and somebody's playing
it's
an accordion.
It's a very special atmosphere.
It is indeed. Someone's playing an accordion or whatever, and you have a carnival festival.
Absolutely.
Atmosphere that you don't get anywhere else.
Mick Roach, Pat Hartigan, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Two great legends of the Munster Championship and indeed of hurling. For the moment, we have lots of more people for you to meet later on, but for the moment, let's go back to you, Des.
All right, thank you very much, Marty. Well, I'm joined now by a couple of fellas who soldiered together for Tipperary with great success. Tony Nealon is here, Len Gaynor. Tony, Jimmy Doyle was, when we were talking about great names there of Munster Hurling, Jimmy Doyle was one of those names of Tipperary. Tell us what made Jimmy so special.
Well, I think Jimmy, you see, he was frail. He wasn't that big or strong, but he was supreme. He was a supreme artist. You know, his subtlety was unbelievable. And the most amazing thing about him, he loved to bring other players into the game. It was a great honour and privilege to play with him, because he'd bring you on, he'd feed you with the ball, he could pass the ball on very well, and he could score from any angle. He didn't even have to stand over a second over a free and it was over the bar. But, I mean, without Jimmy, we wouldn't have won half the games we won, you know. He was the master craftsman, there's no doubt about it. But he had a great sense of anticipation as well. Like, as I say, he wasn't strong, he wasn't physical like Mackie and Ring, but he'd turn up in the right position and he'd sneak a goal there or slip in for it, you know. And, well, he did an awful lot of practice from a very young age. Any man who played in 4 All-Ireland minors is unbelievable. And then came on and the one day played minor for Tip and played senior as well. So he spent all his time, as he said himself, he wasn't too fond of the books, but he loved the hurling.
He's not the only one, I think, yeah. Well, then, of course, you had great successes, you know, with Tipperary, but you went to Clare as well, and we needed other counties. I mean, it's important that other counties come in. Waterford and Clare are featuring as well, isn't it?
Well, I think so. There are 5 strong counties, I suppose, in the hurling scene in Munster, you know, and Clare had been in the doldrums for a long, long time. 1914, I think, was their last All-Ireland final. And I grew up looking at great players like Jimmy Smith and Mick Hayes and Pat Crone and Nace Jordan and these sort of players, you know, and they had tremendous players, but they hadn't the success to match it. And I was asked would I go there in 91, and after consideration I did, you know. I had spent 5 good years, I suppose, in St. Flannan's College, and I did a lot of hurling there and learnt a lot about hurling there, so I felt maybe I owed them something, you know, and I went back there. I'm not saying I gave them a lot now, but I gave them 4 of my years anyway and brought them on a bit.
Yeah, but it is important, isn't it, that it goes around. If it's just, you know, Cork and Tip dominating, it's not great for the province.
Without a doubt, you know, that's what brings the freshness into the game, and that's what the game is all about, that everyone gets their chance. And Clare, you know, they came there in 95 and 97 with Gerard Loughnane in charge. And it was great to see them and to see the newcomers in there and to see them challenging. And that's one of the great things about Munster Hurling, that there's five counties there. Yeah. At the start of any year, they all feel they can win that Munster Championship. And that's what makes it great.
All right. And we have Kerry represented here as well, as you point out. Thanks, Len. Well, coming up, lots more Munster Hurling memories. But after the break, it's today's two big matches. Dublin versus Kilkenny in the Leinster Hurling final and Cork versus Limerick in the Munster final decider. Stay with us.